right, everyone, welcome to 2023. This is Prevail's Compliance Corner. I'm Orly Berlov, and this is my colleague, Noel Vestal.
Hello.
Happy New Year. Last year was a great year. We started the Compliance Corner channel and have been truly impressed and amazed by the level of response we've gotten. So thank you to all of our audience. Thank you to all the people who liked and shared our videos. And we hope to not disappoint in 2023 and look forward to being just as good and better. And so with that, no, let's kick off today's topic. You know, it's something that we've talked about before, but we're going to kind of double down on it. And that is the topic of DFARS 7019. So when Noelle and I were talking about it before we kicked on the camera, she called it like the redheaded stepchild of DFARS.
Nobody ever talks about 7019. Everybody loves 7012. Let's talk about 7012. Nobody ever talks about 7019.
Hence the term redheaded stepchild.
Indeed.
Actually, I've never known a redheaded stepchild, but,
either, but
somehow that term came about. So I hope we're not offending anyone with red hair or someone who is a stepchild. Anyway, all good stuff. But the reason why 7019 is intriguing is because DFARS 7012 has been around for a while, since 2017. And then you have 7019, 7020, and 7021 that came out with the DFARS interim rule that kind of cement a lot of the things that you were supposed to be doing. So we're going to kick off today's conversation by describing a bit about what 7019 is and what it requires defense contractors to do and how people can get compliance going with 7019.
I like it.
You like it? All right. So I feel like there should be balloons falling in the air.
Yeah, fireworks. Thing like Happy New Year.
Yeah.
Something exciting.
But let's kick this off and start just talking about what is DFARS 7019? You know, simple softball question, but let's put that out there.
It's a great one because, again, one of the things that you and I were talking about before we started that I have been amazed by is how many people I talk to who are, you know, potential customers or customers at Prevail who have never read the clauses in their contract. Who just
read the freaking manual.
I mean, literally have no idea what clauses they're responsible for. So that I want to start out with that PSA. Please, please read your contracts. Please read the clauses. Like you need to understand that every time that you are sending an invoice, every time you are taking money from the government, you are saying that you're doing all the things in that contract. So you should kind of know what they are. And one of them is 7019, pretty much in every contract in the DoD at this point. And the 7019 clause is kind of like, it piggybacks on the 7012. So 7012, as we all know, is, you know, you have to do your 800-171 compliance and your CSP has to be FedRAMP moderate or equivalent. You have to
CSP is cloud service provider for those.
Thank you. Yes, cloud service provider. It also talks about like, you know, how you report incidents and, you know, and imaging for your servers, blah, blah, blah. That's all. Pretty much most people in the DoD have some idea of what that clause is.
Right.
However, 7019 is the one that came about a year, 2 years after 7012. And it sort of, instead of just saying, oh, you know, you signed 7012 and you're saying that you're doing, you know, 800-171. Now 7019 is kind of like the next step where it was, okay, great. You're saying you're doing it. We need you to report it to us
right.
So that we can see what that is. So 7019 states that you have to use SPRS, which is the supplier risk. I'm gonna see if I can remember it. Supplier risk something system. Anyway, the point is that SPRS is a system that the government started where you go in as the, you know, as the company who's working with the DoD, you go in and it has all 110 of those controls, this, you know, the 800-171 controls that you were referenced in 7012.
Right.
You go in and say either fully implemented, partially implemented, planned, or basically, or non-applicable. If you say anything is planned, you don't get any credit. If you say something is partially implemented, you don't get any credit.
You only get credit for full.
You only get credit for fully implemented controls. Now you can put in there that you are planning something or it is partially implemented and that's totally fine because you want to be as honest as you can. That's another thing that sort of happened when 7019 came out. you know, a lot of these contracts, people had 7019, and it was, you know, these cores were like, hey, you have to report to SPERS. Companies were like, sure, I'll totally go in there. And they just said fully implemented for everything because nobody was really checking up on them that often. Now, that is very different now than it was a few years ago when 7019 came out. So be as honest as you can right in there. It doesn't have to be a perfect score. In fact, they don't expect it to be, but it does need to be an honest score.
Yeah. So 7019 says just go ahead and put in your NIST 800, how many of the 110 controls NIST 800-171 you meet. And essentially it's taking 7012 and putting some sort of requirement around it, because before that people were, it was best practice. It was kind of advised to do a self-assessment and know your score. Here you actually have to report it.
Exactly.
So let's make this clear. Who does 7019 apply to?
So 7019 applies to any person, any organization who has a 7019 clause, which is the vast majority, if not, you know, close to all contracts that come out in the DoD at this point. I never say all because there's always some outlier somewhere, right?
Someone out there saying, Noel, you got that wrong.
No, I don't have one. But again, that's why, you know, we started this by saying, look at your contract. If you have a 7019 clause, and you probably do, then that means that you need to be reporting to SPERS. Most people who have a 7019 clause, their core or their KO or some contracting representative from the government has probably yelled and screamed at them about, like, hey, you need to put your score in.
Right.
But if they haven't for some reason, if you have a core that maybe is busy with other stuff or hasn't thought about it or hasn't got you or whatever, you still need to understand that it doesn't matter. It's not the core's responsibility to remind you to do your job.
Right.
It's just not. So you need to take that proactive approach. And if you haven't done your SPER, if you haven't inputted your SPER score and you have a 7019 clause, you need to get on that as soon as possible.
So people have a 7012 clause. Something we've talked about. They also have a 7019 clause right below it.
Yeah. Like I'd say 99.8% of the time, you're going to have both of them. Again, there could always be an outlier. There could always be there's contracts in the DoD are, you know, pretty consistent, but there's always some kind of outlier. But yeah, the vast majority, like, and again, we're talking like almost everyone who is in the DIB is going to have a 7012 clause and then subsequently a 7019 clause, because they kind of work together at this point. They usually don't put 7012 in any contract without also putting 7019, because again, like we talked about, when 7012 came out by itself, nobody was actually doing what they were supposed to do. And the government had no way to check up on anybody easily. Whereas if you insist that they do a SPER score, then let's say for the sake of argument, you go in and do your SPER score and you say you're 110 out of 110. And then some incident happens, you know, 2 months later, 3 months later, a year later, whatever it is.
Cyber incident, to be clear.
A cyber incident, thank you. Like some sort of problem, you know, whatever right. that may be. The government has to be notified about it for whatever reason. You notify them, you follow your 7012 where you're supposed to, you know, report to them. They come in and investigate and find out the reason that incident happened is because you were not 110 out of 110. You were maybe, right. you know, 40 out of 110. And those other, you know, 70 is where your problem came in. If you had done those things, the incident wouldn't have happened. Then you have the whole situation with false claims and you can get sued. Yeah. And there's all kinds of bad things that come from that.
Right. So, you know, most people we'd like to believe are, and I think this is quite true, are going to try and give their best effort and do what they're required to do and be as honest with as possible in submitting their score. I guess the question is, in terms of meeting 7019, we talked about meeting it by seeing how you meet the 110 NIST 800-171 controls. Slight rub in that ointment is, well, you either meet it or you don't meet it. And in order to know how you meet it, you have to do what's listed in NIST 800-171A. Which is the assessment guide. So can you just speak to that? First, what is the difference? And then how people should assess themselves?
Absolutely. So that is where a lot of confusion comes in for people. This happens on the CMMC side as well. It's the same kind of idea. And especially since CMMC, you know, is the flow down from NIST 800-171. So it makes sense that that confusion just flowed down with that as well. So if I am going into SPERS, all I'm seeing are the controls. So the control numbers like 3.1.1, 3.1.2, et cetera, all the way down for the 110. I am not seeing the objectives. The objectives for each one of those controls are listed in 800-171A, which is like the assessor's guide. If you look in there, each one of those controls, 3.1.1, for example, will have 3.1.1A, 3.1.1B, 3.1.1C, et cetera, for however many objectives there are. Each one of those objectives needs to be addressed. Now, those objectives roll up into the control, right? I mean, they're all things that are specific to that control, but you just have to make sure that you've checked the box on all those objectives before you say, yes, this is fully implemented. Because if you say it's fully implemented and you haven't implemented, you know, part of those objectives, that is a very easy way for an assessor, if you do have some sort of incident with, you know, some sort of cybersecurity incident and the DoD comes to investigate, they can look at that and say, well, you know, objective one and two here, or A and B, you didn't address in this control, and that's what caused this problem.
I mean, it could also just be an incident where the DIPCAC says, yep, it's your lucky day, we're going to inspect your company.
Absolutely. Random assessments are a thing. They are now
random
a thing.
Acts of assessment.
Right, exactly. And the other thing to remember too, is that SPR score, that 7019 clause, as of the June memo from the DoD last, you know, June of 2022, it states that a Corps or K or any contracting representative from the government has the right and the obligation to look at your SPR score now and to actually be like, oh, okay. And if it says 110 out of 110 and they feel like that's not true, or if they have any kind of feeling of like, I don't know if this is right, they can then ask you for what's kind of termed a paper audit, or, hey, I need to see your SSP and make sure you actually are doing what you say you're doing. Right. And if the Corps is like, well, this isn't working for me, they can then report you if they want to. That is in their right.
They could. So just to be clear, you know, when you're submitting your score to the SPRS database, you need to make sure that you are meeting the controls of NIST 800-171A to confirm that you are indeed meeting the control. One of those controls, let's just call it out, is that you should have a system security plan, an SSP.
Yes.
And so it's not just meeting the controls, but you should also have a system security plan that says how you are meeting each objective.
Correct. And you have to have an SSP. So the SSP control for NIST 800-171 is 3.12.4. And if you look in SPRS, the way that, first of all, the SPRS math is very confusing. So just if you haven't done a SPRS score before, it starts at -203.
Okay.
I don't know why. I have never been able to find out why it starts at -203. I've asked multiple people over the years. No one seems to have an answer for me. If you have an answer, please let me know. I would love to know. But it starts at -203. Each one of the individual controls has different control values, like 5 points, 3 points, and 1 point. Now, the one for 3.12.4, which is saying that you have to have a system security plan, it actually states there that if you say that's not, if it's anything other than fully implemented, you cannot put in a SPR score. Basically, your SPR score can't happen without an SSP. So you have to have an SSP in order to even put in any of the other 109 controls.
Wow. That's a key something to call out, right? Yeah. Why we keep on hammering on the SSP. I think, though, we've kind of stated those points. One thing that I know a lot of people kind of get caught up in is, okay, I've done my self-assessment. I have my system security plan. How do I go about reporting my score? How does this whole SPRS database thing work? Like, where do I go?
Definitely. Well, first and foremost, if you have a Corps or a KO who's really on top of things, they're going to send you this information most likely. So if they do not, you can literally Google it and find it. And it's all the instructions that you need. One thing that I like to make sure people are aware of is that SPRS, for some reason, will only allow one person from your organization to be able to enter information. That's it.
A very special person.
So when you're doing this, when you decide whoever that person is, make sure it's somebody who really is going to be around for a while. Because if you have to change that person, it's a huge pain. And yeah, there's no backup person that you can
add. Life insurance policy on whoever you choose to have this role, because they are the most valuable player in your company.
Indeed. So it's definitely it's a weird process. I don't know why they don't give you a backup person at the least, right? But they don't do that. At least they haven't since I've looked at it. So when you go in, it's that one person who can sign in, that one person who can fill out the information, and that one person who then kind of digitally signs and, you know, clicks the box and says, yes, I attest to the fact that all this stuff is right. So that one person is also now completely responsible for that score.
Right.
So it's another thing to think about too. Like, if you have somebody who's like maybe your IT manager going in and doing that, you're making that IT manager responsible for that score. Like, that's probably not the best way to handle it.
Probably C-suite.
Yeah, something on the C-suite. Usually it's the CEO who does it, or a COO or a CFO or something like that. So usually it's something at the C-suite. Doesn't have to be, but that's normally how it works, just because it is so imperative. And it's a big deal for your company. I mean, if somebody goes in there and puts in the wrong stuff, like, you're liable as a company. So it's definitely something to consider.
Yeah, not something to take lightly. Yeah, I think we get the point there. I think the last thing we should mention, and we discussed this earlier, just lightly, you know, the consequences of not having a 7019 score and not meeting your 7019 requirements are pretty well stated in the June memo, and we'll put a link to that memo in the show notes. But the June memo says contractors must implement all of the NIST 800-171 requirements. And have a plan of action and milestones for each requirement not yet implemented. Failure to have or make progress on a plan to implement NIST 800-171 requirements may be considered a material breach of contract.
Yeah, nobody likes that sentence. That's not good. Yeah, you don't want to be in a situation where the United States government, the DoD specifically, comes and investigates you because you lied.
Misrepresented. Never a good idea.
It's never a good idea. So even if your score is not great, right? Let's say that your SPR score, you put it in and it's like negative 60. That's fine. As long as you're putting those poems in place, like we talked about, and working towards, you know, making it better, you can update that score whenever you have updates to make, if that's something that you want to do. So you can show the government that you're trying to get things better. But it, definitely do not go in there thinking, well, nobody's really going to look at this. So I'll just put in whatever I want. People are looking at it more now than they ever have, and it's just going to get worse. They're going to be looking at it more often, not less.
Yep. All right. And with that, I think we've covered the topic. We'll be going through some of these other NIST controls in the weeks to come. These other DFARS topics in the weeks to come, DFARS 7020 and 7021. But we look forward to discussing those at another Compliance Corner. For now, what do we say? What should we say? Goodbye.
Thank you.
Thank you. Oh, right. See, you're Southern. You always have manners.
I know. Well, I don't know. It's just how it is. Thank you all so much for watching. We appreciate all of you. Like Orly said, it's been a fantastic year with Compliance Corner, and we hope that we can just do better, even better than we did last year.
There you go. All right. Bye, everyone.
Bye.